Hello and a very warm welcome back to the garden. Everyone at the moment is focusing on perhaps the most fun things, which is starting off new plants. Lots of sowing, lots of seedlings, lots of transplantings. It's absolutely amazing. In this video, I want to show you something that is going to help improve your seedling and sowing success and to lead to better harvest down the line. And also not just to healthier plants, but to also help improve your soil as well. And that's by creating something called a fermented plant juice out of nettles. It's really easy to do, inspired by Korean natural farming. So before I show you how to make it and how to use it, I'm inviting Nigel Palmer, author of the Regenerative Grower's Guide to Garden Amendments, to firstly explain what on earth is a plant juice and also why nettles.
So a very warm welcome back, Nigel. It's great to have you on the channel yet again. So after reading your book and also taking part of your wonderful workshop of five classes, of which you're going to be running again from the 24th of April, I believe, I kind of found out that I felt I was missing a lot of potential from the garden. And it struck me how interesting these amendments were. And in this video, we're looking at fermented plant juices. So could you tell us what is a fermented plant juice and also what are their benefits?
Fermented plant juices are exactly what they say, fermented plants. And then you use the liquid from that and that's the juice. I guess the first thing is that when we use plants, we're extracting the minerals from that plant. And by definition, we're getting juices in forms that plants can use because they come from plants. So the process itself of fermenting plants is simply taking plants and mixing it with organic brown sugar and allowing osmosis to draw out the liquid within that plant. Once the liquid is out, then we can strain it and we have a jar of fermented plant juice.
Effectively, you're using plants to feed plants.
That's exactly right. And what's really cool about it is different plants have different mineral accumulations in them. And also, some of them are very broad spectrum and have a lot of minerals in them, like dandelion or stinging nettle.
What do you mean by broad spectrum?
That's a great question. If you read books about plants and what they need, there's a list of 14, 16, depending on the resource that you use, different minerals that plants need in order to thrive. And they're in very different proportions, and some of them are very small amounts. But when you use a stinging nettle, for instance, when you ferment a stinging nettle, you're getting all of them because they're all there. And so you're actually able to extract all of them and in a proportion that plants want and will use. Also, what's really fun about this is these fermentations are in forms that plants can use directly. So they don't have to go into the soil solution. They don't have to be digested by the biology in the solution and fed back through the roots. They can be applied directly to the leaves of the plants themselves.
That's amazing. And later on, after doing the tutorial, I'm going to ask you about all the ways that you can use fermented plant juice, all the methods of application. It's quite amazing. And I think people are going to learn a lot about that. Now, something that a lot of gardeners know is just getting a bucket of water and sticking a load of plant material in, and then it turns really smelly. What's the difference between just going that route with the water and like putting in dock or nettles or comfrey versus actually instead doing a plant fermentation? Why should we bother with that?
That's really a fun question. And this is why I started doing analysis on these different recipes. I started off doing exactly that. I took my dandelions, put them in a bucket of rainwater and let it go. And as you say, it really stunk pretty badly.
Yeah, so bad.
It's bad. But my plants didn't seem to mind. I was the only one, well, and the other people living in my house seemed to mind. And it seemed like the right thing to do at the time. When you ferment the plant, you get a different concentration of those minerals. If you look in some of the analysis that I've done, you can see that weed in the bucket will produce minerals and it will be broad spectrum. And you can do that. That's an ultimate and free free amendments. But if you would use organic brown sugar and ferment it, you're getting higher concentrations of those minerals. And you're also getting something that is shelf stable and does not smell terribly. And then when we talk about the proportions that we're actually using, we're gonna dilute that 500 to one. So a quart turns out to be 125 gallons of it very quickly.
Which means it doesn't take much to actually get a lot.
If I wanna feed my plant, I can build a compost pile, and my compost piles take me 2 years to build. I build it, layer it, mineralize it, biologicalize it, and then in the end of a year, it sits for a year, and then I use it the third year. So that's going to take a long time to actually get that product. Furthermore, when I put it into the garden, into the soil, it has to be assimilated by the soil biology and gotten into the soil solution. And only then can it be absorbed by the roots and up into the plant. So it's a viable methodology. It's a virtuous methodology, but it takes a lot of time. When I make a fermented plant juice or a vinegar extraction, I have that on my shelf within a couple of weeks. And it's shelf stable, and I'm diluting it, and I can apply it directly as a foliar spray to my plants. When you apply things to the leaf of a plant as a foliar spray, you are providing minerals and nutrients to that plant almost immediately. Those are absorbed within hours, sometimes minutes. And so you're short-circuiting all of that digestion process when you make a fermented plant juice or a vinegar extraction compared to putting it on the compost pile. But the easy answer is both of them are very important tools that we have at our disposal. And, you know, just one more point about these fermented plant juice and vinegar extractions. They take such little time to do. Most people have to drive 5, 10, 15 minutes in one direction to the store to buy those things. Yeah. You can make this stuff in the time it would take you to go there and come back.
It's so quick and easy. It's amazing. So as you know, it's kind of the start of the growing season, and depending where you are either kind of right at the beginning or midway through in terms of spring and a lot of growing and sowing. And this tutorial in this video is about making a fermented plant juice out of nettles. So what are the specific benefits that nettles bring to home growers at this time of year?
Well, of course, the nettle is broad spectrum, and that's one of its most useful characteristics. It has a lot of just about all of the minerals that plants want in them. And when you're starting off zero germination, let's say, it's very important to make sure that that seed gets all the nutrition it can. It's just like a baby. The first 2 years of development of a human life really determines much of the characteristics that that child, person, adult will have. And so these very beginning phases of a plant's life are no different. So by making sure that the plant has all the nutrients it needs, you can assure yourself that you're giving it the best start possible.
To get started with making a fermented plant juice, here are the things that you need. You want a mixing bowl and some fabric, address labels, a 500 milliliter and a 1 liter glass jar, brown sugar, a rubber band, weighing scales, pen, scissors, funnel, and then to collect the nettles, a bucket and some gloves. And another thing you need as well is a rock that can fit through the jar. Just make sure that it's sterilized by boiling it in some water for around 5 to 10 minutes. Now, the great thing about making a fermented plant juice is you can do it on any scale. The recipe that I'm going to show you at the moment is for a small scale, making it in a 1 liter jar. Now you can easily double this or quadruple it. And all you need to do is just double the weight of your plant material and also of the brown sugar. So for a 1 liter jar, you want to collect around 125 grams of plant material. So in this case, it's going to be nettles. Now the best time to pick nettles or anything to make a fermented plant juice is really early in the morning. So when there's still dew on the leaves. Now, of course, if you can't do this, such as if you can't get to your allotment in time, then the goal is to do it as early as possible in the day to have the best success. Once you've collected your plant material, you don't want to water it, okay? You wanna keep the natural biology that is already there and present. Now, once you've got that 125 grams or your equivalent, so if you wanna do a double batch, that might be around 250 grams of plant material. You then want to look at adding brown sugar. So for kind of drier materials, such as nettles, you want to use a ratio of, in weight, 3 parts nettles to 2 parts of brown sugar. So in this case, if I've got about 125 grams approximately of nettles, I'm going to add about 80, 85 grams of brown sugar, and I'm going to mix this up nicely. Whilst you're mixing the nettles and the brown sugar together, you can tear it up a little bit, but it really doesn't need to be torn up that much at all. Once you've combined the two ingredients together really thoroughly, you want to move these into your jar, your bigger jar. So in this case, I'm going to be placing these into the 1 liter jar. And then finish off just by sprinkling a very light layer of brown sugar over the top of the nettle mixture. Now, after you've done this, you want to get that stone that has been sterilized and place this on top. And this is going to help initiate fermentation by adding some weight to start pushing down that plant material as well as a brown sugar. Once you've done this, you want to cover the entire jar with a muslin or some other similar fabric. And you might want to use something like a rubber band just to hold it into place, just to allow it to breathe nicely. And you want to place this jar in a place that has room temperature, around 20 degrees Celsius or 70 degrees Fahrenheit. It needs to be a dry, well-ventilated place, but out of direct sunlight. So if you have, say, a kitchen worktop that isn't near the window, that will be a perfect place to put this jar to let it ferment. And after just a few hours, you'll see that a brown juice will begin to appear. So you will know that it's starting to work its magic. And you just want to keep it going. Leave it for a few days, something like 5 days, 6 days, and you'll see that there'll be a really dark, really kind of brown, dark, sticky liquid, which is that highly concentrated fermented plant juice. A good idea is to keep track of what you're making. So utilize labels on the side of the jars, just so you know what you're making, kind of the quantities or ratios of the materials within it. And also, really importantly, the date. So you're not second guessing yourself whether it's been in for a week or potentially 2 weeks, because we all know how busy life is. So after around 5 or 6 days, this fermented plant juice will be ready for straining. So this is when you have your smaller glass jar, and then you're gonna place the funnel over the top. And then you can either have some kind of sieve, or you can use something like muslin that you place over the top, and then turn the big jar over and kind of rest it or balance it over the top, and it will start to release liquid. Once you see the juice is starting to drip into that jar, just leave it. You could leave it overnight, come back the next morning, give it a good 12 hours or so before removing it. And don't be tempted to squeeze it, just let kind of gravity pull out the best juices to fill up that jar. And obviously the amount you're gonna get in terms of the fermented plant juice depends on the moisture content of when you pick those plants. Now, after you've done that, you want to add a lid, label it so you know exactly what it is, add some more detail onto it if you fancy, for example, the date of when it was bottled. And now you can place this on a shelf in a stable place, for example, a room temperature, out of direct sunlight shelf that you might have in your house. And it's all good and ready for use.
So whether people have made the juice or they have just set off their first batch and it's fermenting away, and I've said this has probably been going for about 4 or 5 days, and I've got a really loose lid on, it smells really good. It's really weird. It's almost like a sweet grass. It doesn't smell anything like just putting it in a bucket of water and running a mile. So let's explore. Now we've made it, we need to know how to use it. So one of the things that interested me the most, and it's something that I haven't really heard before, apart from just soaking seeds in water before sowing to help germinating. But you say that we should actually look at soaking seeds in diluted fermented plant juice. So maybe just very briefly mention, remind us again, the benefits of that. And how should we do it? Like, what sort of quantities? How long should we soak seeds for?
Yeah. So what I do is I take a relatively small jar, maybe half a cup, and put rainwater in it. And I'll take an eyedropper and put in a few drops of fermented plant juice in it. Now, that ratio is probably going to be a little bit higher than the 500-1 that you might want to use for applying to a plant itself. But that's okay. This is going to be on the outside of the seed. And then I put my seeds in that jar, and I'll just let it sit for as much as, I'll start off with 20 minutes maybe. I could even go longer, hour. This is where experimentation comes in. It depends on the seed. It depends on all kinds of things, how you're going to plant it, blah, blah, blah. And so I reckon the best thing to do is to take notes and record what you do. And if you have the time or the inclination, try soaking some and not soaking some, and see what kind of a difference you get. But you can soak seeds for a long time. I've read people soaking seeds for several hours, many hours, in order to make sure that that liquid is absorbed into the seed. Some seeds are harder than others, for instance. So soaking seeds is important, and I soak seeds for at least 20 minutes, maybe something like that, at least. And the other thing is this goes along with garden time. If your seeds happen to be in there longer because you forgot and you want to plant something and all of a sudden that little shiny object caught your eye, that's okay, right? That's okay. So it's an experimental thing, I think.
So let's explore drenching a little bit more. You said a ratio of 1 to 500 roughly. And also, is there a time of day that we should best apply a drench, and should we maybe pre-water first and then put the drench on, or can you just be flexible?
Sure. So when I start with, let's start with pots that you're going to start right now, not in the ground. I make soil pots. So my pot is nothing but soil, and there's all kinds of reasons why to do that. We could have another conversation about that if you haven't already. And so when I'm watering, the first thing I'll do is I'm going to spray a fine mist on the surface of that soil pot to make sure that the local vicinity of that seed is getting wet. Mm-hmm. Once that seed starts to germinate, I know that little noodle is finding its way down in the pot. Now I'm going to start watering from the bottom. I'm actually going to fill the bottom of the tray up with fermented plant juice minerals. And so now that noodle is going to be going looking for the water, and that water is going to absorb into the pot and keep the whole soil pot nice and moist. And so by doing this inside, I'm assuring that seed in those first few weeks, days of its life are getting everything that it possibly can. So when you're out in the garden and you've got seeds in the ground, you've soaked them if you could, and if you can't, then you water them with the fermented plant juice mineral extraction on a regular basis, making sure A, it stays moist, and B, that those minerals are present. So those are the kind of two drenching ideas for germination.
Brilliant. And then the other thing, the third kind of main method is foliar spraying. So what kind of dilution ratios do you do for that? And is there a best time of day?
Yeah, definitely. Foliar spraying. As soon as you get those first 2-3 leaves on the plant, those leaves are all sort of ready to absorb the foliar sprays. And a foliar spraying should be done on a regular basis, 7 to 10 days. 7 days is nice for most people because most of the people work on a 7-day basis. I can't figure it out, but 7 days, right, Hugh?
If there's like 8 days a week, you know what the Beatles say.
There you go. So foliar spraying is really important. 500-1 is a good place to start. And of course, doing it in the morning is the best time to foliar spray. This is when there's already dew on the leaves. There's moisture on the leaves. So when you foliar spray, you're adding to that moisture on the leaf, which will be absorbed by the leaf, and it'll stay on the leaf for a long period of time. That's the goal with foliar spraying, is you want that foliar spray to stay on the leaf for as long a period of time as possible to be absorbed by the leaf itself.
Now, is there a reason to not foliar spray at kind of dusk, you know, as you're moving late afternoon, moving into evening?
Well, so when you have lots of moisture on the plant leaf for a long period of time, you're inviting fungus and other pathogens on that leaf to do their thing, if you will. So while it's not terrible to do that, it's not optimal to do that.
I know there's a lot of people who'd like to find out more about foliar sprays. So there's a video on your channel where I ask you more questions about foliar sprays and how they work, and how there's kind of this feeling based on industrial agriculture that anything that is sprayed is bad. But really, there's a whole different story to that. And it's really interesting when we look into photosynthesis efficiency and how important that is, and how that spraying your plants with the right stuff can actually help build a healthier soil. So for anyone interested, there's going to be a link popping up, or you can find it down below in the description. And Nigel, I'd love you to talk briefly about your upcoming workshop, because I went on it earlier this year. It was over 5 sessions. I absolutely loved it. It's my favorite, most mind-blowing gardening workshop I've been on. So can you give us a little flavor of what people can expect?
Yeah, the course is offering a variety of things in it. One is a model or a context with which to make decisions going forward, which is very important, rather than just being told to go and do something. And then it gives a lot of methods on how to go about doing those things. And it covers all of the mineral extractions, the biological amendments, and some of the most important tools out there: cover cropping, composting, and mulching. The nice thing is that both the novice and the experienced gardener are going to get a lot out of this. One of the best comments that I've gotten is the fact that some novices were a little bit uptight about it because of the breadth of knowledge, but then they found that they could approach it. And that's very, very important to me. Also, as the experienced gardeners, they also got a lot of context, which they didn't have previously. And despite all of the information that's there, there's always the book now that you can go back on to refresh your memory on the things that are covered in the course.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what I'm finding. Like, I've used the book so much, it doesn't sit flat anymore and stuff. And I felt that having that kind of discipline of going on your workshop and being able to ask you questions and having questions from other people, it was such a great group. And yeah, good luck with your next one. And thank you so much for your help today. Fingers crossed, I'll be able to drag you on to another video on this channel in a short while.
It'd be my pleasure to join you again here. Thank you.
Cheers, Nigel. All the best.
Cheers.